already on.
I think
okay. If it does, by any chance, when you get it, be off.
Girls just want to have fun.
It's just this button right here, and you just hold it.
Okay.
It should be good. I'm not worried about praying. I'm not worried about logistics because I just have that here. Enough.
Hello.
Tired, but good. We had a lot of campers. We had a couple of new ones this year.
You can sit right where your mic is.
Okay.
Christina just
yep.
Her stuff right
September
here, so
1st,
I'll
start.
Go get my notebook. I gotta meet some people. I don't like sitting by myself.
Thank you.
Good morning. Good to see you all here today. We are in God's presence. We're here to worship the Lord. Let's stand up and raise our voices to God and give him the glory today.
Let's sing. Praise him, you heavens and all that's above. Praise him, you angels and heavenly hosts. Let the whole earth praise him. Praise him, the sun, moon, and bright shining stars. Praise him, you heavens and waters and skies.
Good morning and welcome to Pathfinder Church. It's wonderful to see all of you here today. We come here for doing two things really today. First of all, we come here to turn our eyes to God, to give him the glory, to worship him, to give him all the honor and worship that he deserves. That's why we're here, to worship the Lord. And second, we come here today recognizing that we are all sinners. We are all sinners in need of God's grace. So we come here today to invite the Holy Spirit into our hearts, to cleanse us, to renew us, to sanctify us, to make us more like Jesus. Listen to these words from Psalm 51. It says this: create in me a clean heart, O God. Renew a loyal spirit within me. Let's say these words together. Create in me a clean heart, O God. Renew a loyal spirit within me. We turn our eyes to Jesus and we trust in Jesus to do this for us, to create in us a clean heart. We're going to continue to worship the Lord now. If you're joining us online, we're glad that you are with us. We want you to leave a comment on Facebook Live. Say hi so that we know you're here. Let's all go before God and worship the Lord together. Let's sing. Sing.
'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus and to take him at his word, just to rest upon his promise and to know the saith the Lord. Oh, how sweet to trust in Jesus, just to trust his cleansing blood, and in simple faith to plunge beneath the healing cleansing blood. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I've proved him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust him.
Worship his holy name.
is failing. The end draws near, and my time has come. Still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore. Bless the Lord, oh my soul.
Have a seat.
Good morning. Couple announcements this morning. Our August mission focus is for Midwest Missions. We're collecting school supplies for the children. You can go outside these doors and there's a few sticky notes. Just take one and collect what you can and bring it back here for us. Going into the colder months, we will be going back to 8:45 and 10:30 a.m. services, so back to separate services again. Bible presentation Sunday, second grade and older, that will be September 8th during worship, so make sure you have the kiddos here. One more announcement. There was a confusion in the bulletin for the Pathfinder at the movies, so a lot of people were showing up late, but the doors open at 6, and we start the movie at 6:30, and that is for this Friday also.
Come on up, friends. I have something to give you today. Come on up. Hooray, hooray, hello. Good morning, good morning. How are we today? Good. I hear, because I know with my own kids, something important is coming up in a couple weeks. School is starting in a couple weeks. I know that for some of you that might be not the greatest news, but sorry, you have to go back to school. I always tell my kids, if you can learn everything, well, actually, it was my husband that said this. If you can learn everything on the very first day, then you don't have to go back the next day. And then their dad would ask them a very hard question, and they didn't know the answer, so then they had to go back the second day. But anyway, I wonder if you guys remember back at Easter time, Brother Don had a whole sermon about seeing Jesus. Do you remember what was hidden all over the church? Do you remember? Yeah, we had little mini Jesuses. So, yeah, they were itty-bitty, like what I have in my bucket, right? They're back. But I have more of them because I have a challenge for you as you go back to school. I would like you to take one of these mini Jesus and put them in your lunchbox or in your desk or in somewhere that you will see them every single day, okay? As a reminder that Jesus should always be with us, but there's a challenge that goes with it. If somebody asks you about the mini Jesus, you need to tell them about Jesus and then give it to them. Because Jesus is something that we don't want to hide to ourselves, right? We should have Jesus in our hearts, but we don't want to just hide it and not tell anybody about it. So I'm going to challenge you to take a Jesus and put it somewhere in your, in something that you see every day, your lunchbox, your desk, somewhere at school, your locker, if you have a locker. And then when somebody asks you about it, you're going to give them to them and tell them about Jesus. And I have so many in here, so if you give yours away, come get another one, okay? And we're going to spread the word of Jesus throughout our schools. Does that sound like a challenge that you can do? You think so? So she said, if I hide it in my desk, the only person that'll see me is me and my teacher. Well, then maybe you got to pick a different spot. Maybe on your desk. Maybe you could take a little piece of tape and tape it to the top of your desk. Think about that. It has to be somewhere where somebody might just see it so that they can ask about Jesus, okay? So it's going to be like a little bit scary maybe for some of you to talk about Jesus. But even if you just give them the little figure, and then when you feel brave enough, you can talk about Jesus with your friends, okay? Because Jesus wants us to share about him everywhere, not just talk about him at church, right? Yeah. So I know I gave one to these two guys, but come get a Jesus and take it with you. And if you have a sibling in the back somewhere, you can take one for them as well. And boys and girls or adults, you're welcome to come and take a Jesus. They'll be out at the Connect Desk so you can take it and share it in your lives too, because it's not just for the kids, it's for everybody. All right, guys, you can head off to kids' worship. Go with brother. Just go that way. There you go. Go ahead.
Good morning, beloved. How are we doing this morning? Outstanding. So listen, during this past week, let's see, what did I see? I saw nearly 60 children down in our gymnasium on Wednesday or Thursday. I don't remember which day it was. I looked out the windows out in the classroom here and saw all these children playing in our gymnasium. On Thursday afternoon, I saw 10 or 12 folks gathering together to help plan and think about a sermon series for the future. On Friday, I saw nearly 30 persons in here donating blood. On Monday or Tuesday, I saw scouts running all over the place. I see stuff going on here, Bill, all the time. Thursday morning, men meeting. Thursday afternoon, a bunch of ladies in the morning and in the afternoon out here meeting in our spaces. Things are happening at this church. 16 baptisms so far this year alone. 14 new members, and last week, 5 more people asked me about joining the church. Things are happening at this church. Pickleball is getting ready to start. Softball is just ending. Golf's still going on, although we got rained out Friday morning. So if you golf Friday, come see me. Stuff's going on, and it's exciting to see. Friends, if you ask me why we give because of all the ministries that are going on in this church, because of all the ministries that God is blessing in this church. I was talking with the folks this morning at Donuts with Don, and they're looking at all these puzzles that are all over the place. On average, each week, 45 people come to exchange puzzles at our puzzle exchange. 45! Who'd have thunk it? Things are happening. Let's give to support the ministries of this church and the ministries of our Lord and Savior. Bless you. Bless you, bless you. I hope I didn't just embarrass you. Bless you anyway. The ushers are coming forward to receive our offering.
God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Father God, you are an awesome God. Father, for the way that you lavish your love upon us, for the way that you pour out your mercy and grace upon us every day of our lives, for the way you have blessed this church and blessed these people, we offer you praise and thanksgiving. And we lift up these gifts, tithes, and offerings on behalf of your church. Abundance them, Father. Spread them across the land so that your kingdom might continue to grow and all may hear of the glorious, glorious good news of Jesus the Christ. And all God's people said, amen and amen.
Join with me in hymn number 596.
Tell me thy secret, help me bear the
Again, good morning, beloved. Good morning to all of you that are here with us this morning. Good morning to all of you that are online with us right now live. And for any of you that will be joining us later on in the week, good morning, afternoon, or evening, whenever it might be that you get a chance to join us. We are grateful. By the way, you do know that we have quite a following online, anywhere from 13 to 20 on live on Sunday morning, and then 25 to 30 more during the week throughout. So just want to know we're grateful that all of you are with us. Thank you, thank you, thank you. We're continuing on in our sermon series, Pathfinder at the Movies. Jesus can relate. That's the main theme. Jesus can relate. So each sermon deals with how somehow Jesus can relate with us, how he relates with us. And we use little movie clips to help us expound upon the sermon text. So this morning, the text is very, very familiar. It's from Matthew chapter 4, the first 11 verses. You all will recognize it immediately. It is the temptation of Christ in the wilderness, immediately following his baptism. He gets baptized, the Holy Spirit directs him off into the wilderness, and then this happens. Here we go. Then Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted there by the devil. For 40 days and 40 nights he fasted and became very hungry. During that time, the devil came and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, tell these stones to become loaves of bread." But Jesus told him, "No, the scriptures say people do not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God." Then the devil took him to the holy city, Jerusalem, to the highest point on the temple. And he said, "If you are the Son of God, jump off. For the scriptures say, he will order his angels to protect you. They will hold you up with their hands so that you won't even hurt your foot on a stone." And Jesus responded, "The scriptures also say you must not test the Lord your God." Next, the devil took him to the peak of a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their glory. "I will give it all to you," he said, "if you will kneel down and worship me." "Get out of here, Satan," Jesus told him, "for the scriptures say you must worship the Lord your God and serve only him." Then the devil went away, and angels came and took care of Jesus. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God indeed. Our theme for today, Jesus can relate to temptation. Jesus can relate to temptation. Anybody here ever been tempted before? Oh, come on, there's a whole lot of liars in this place. Come on, there we go, all right, there we go, yeah. Yeah, I want to share with you this morning, and by the way, Miss Jackie knows both of these stories, so I'm not telling anything that she doesn't know already, okay? I want to share with you this morning a moment of temptation in my own personal life, several years ago, a long time ago. As they say, confession is good for the soul. This is no kidding, absolutely true. Within 2 weeks of me proposing to Miss Jackie, and asking her to be my wife. Within 2 weeks, this happened. Two different moments of temptation offered themselves. At the time, I was working in a place called the Gibraltar Trade Center. If anybody remember the Gibraltar Trade Center way over in on the east side? Okay, some people do, good. I was working at the Gibraltar Trade Center. It's a large multi-vendor outlet, all contained in one large warehouse. And I was the head of security there, and often I would stand up on what we called the block, which was a great kind of a big tower, kind of towards the center, not quite in the center, but towards the center, this big tower where you could look out and look out over all of the vendors and all of the area, the entrances and everything, and you could see what was going on. And I would often stand up there, myself or the owner would be up there at any given time. Anyway, a very pretty young lady, who was also very sweet, by the way, very nice young lady, who was a cashier there at the church, at the venue, walked up to the block and to the stairwell, and she, "Hey, got something for you." And okay, great. And she handed it to me, and it was a picture of herself. Uh-huh. Uh-oh, is right. It was a picture of herself in a very scantily clad bikini, the thong type, before they were popular, taken on her recent vacation trip back to Hawaii. She was Hawaiian, of Hawaiian descent. I just asked Miss Jackie to marry me. Okay. Second event again occurred shortly thereafter. Another very pretty young lady who worked in her father's fur outlet in the trade center. They sold furs there. And they sold all kinds of furs, full jackets, half jackets, and then even the little, you know, just the wraparound kind of scarf type one, right? She walks up to the block and says, "I've got something for you." And she hands me an envelope. Okay. Curious, I, of course, open the envelope to discover a picture of her, wrapped only in a fur. All the appropriate parts were covered, but it was clear she had nothing else on but the fur. And then I turned the picture over, and these words were written on the back. This is no lie. "Feel safe, sleep with a security guard." Telling the honest engine truth, both of those events happened within 2 weeks of me asking Miss Jackie to marry me. Temptation lurks, dear friends. It comes in many forms, and at the most inappropriate or inopportune time, I might add, dear friends. I returned both pictures to the young ladies and told them that I was very much engaged to be married and was not looking for any other relationships, but I thanked them. And that was the end of it. And then I did go home and tell Miss Jackie. Our movie for this week is The Little Mermaid, the 1989 classic animated Disney movie. The main character in the movie is Ariel, the little young lady, 16 years old, mermaid princess she is. And she is tempted, you will see, by so many things that she's not supposed to have or her father wishes that she would not have, etc. But most significantly, she is tempted by the world above the water, okay? And a certain young man who is up there as well. Her father has forbidden her to go to the surface anymore after a near miss with a shark. I mean, they had a real, no kidding, urgent near miss, and he said, "No more, I don't want you up there anymore." Now she's tempted to disobey and perhaps do whatever it takes to get what she wants. So here's the movie clip. Pay close attention to how she is tempted in this.
"I want you to keep an extra close watch on this pretty little daughter of his."
"Poor child. Poor sweet child. She has a very serious problem. If only there was something we could do. But there is something. Don't be scared. We represent someone who can help you. Someone who can make all your dreams come true. Just imagine you and your prince together forever. Ursula has great powers. Suit yourself. That was only a suggestion. Yes?"
Ariel, what are you doing here with this riffraff?
I'm going to see Ursula.
This way. I admit that in the past I've been a nasty. They weren't kidding when they called me, well, a witch. But you'll find that nowadays I've mended all my ways, repented, seen the light in me. Magic. It's a talent that I always have possessed. Pathetic. Poor unfortunate souls in pain, in need. This worry is. Flotsam jetsam, now I've got her, boys! Nice work, but poor little princess. It's not you, I.
Daddy, I'm sorry, I.
Very precious commodity.
Out!
After him!
Okay, boys. Shut her down. Thank you. Too busy watching the movie. Throughout the movie, and not just, this was kind of a compilation of a few different scenes, but throughout the movie, Ariel is tempted by much, by a lot. She's tempted by the sunken ship and what treasures it might hold. She's tempted by shiny baubles and that she discovers, which turns out to be a fork and a pipe, a smoking pipe. She has, as she says in the film, gadgets and gizmos galore, but she wants more, right? And of course, she's tempted by the young man that she sees on the ship, the prince, and she's tempted by that life outside. The grass is always greener on the other side of the tracks, if you will. So now we can certainly chalk up this to true love for Ariel, and however, you know, she falls in love with the prince and she is tempted by him, but she becomes so tempted that she begins to do dangerous things, including colluding with Ursula the Sea Witch in order to get what she wants. And there's where she goes downhill. And of course, it gets her into a lot of trouble in the movie, right? And her father, the king, must come and ultimately rectify the situation by sacrificing himself, basically, right? And she's unable to get out of the temptation, the things that she was tempted by. She's unable to free herself. It takes somebody else to come and set her free. Because it's very difficult, dear friends, it's often very true that when we dig ourselves a hole via temptation, it's extremely, extremely difficult to get out of it, okay? So for all of us this morning, by what are you tempted? Is it stuff? Is it keeping up with the Joneses next door? Is it alcohol? Is it the opposite sex? Is it the same sex? Is it pornography? Fame, fortune, a career, better grades, more money? What are you tempted by? And have you gotten yourself into some trouble with those temptations if you succumbed to them? Has temptation cost you a marriage, peace of mind, a significant family relationship, a job? I can only imagine what might have become of Miss Jackie's and my relationship that has now lasted almost 40 years and 3 children and a grandbaby. What would have happened if I had succumbed to the temptation of one of those pretty young ladies? And I'm here to tell you, in those days, I was no saint, okay? Let's just be clear, I was not a pastor, nor was I a saint, okay? but I did not succumb. So as usual, God has something to say about all of this in his holy word, thankfully. We read the story of Jesus' temptation in the wilderness at the start of the sermon, and we ask ourselves, what can Jesus teach us about temptation, and how does temptation try to trick us? So that's what I want us to focus on. How does temptation trick us, and what does Jesus do in response? Okay? So first and foremost, the thing that we can say about temptation is that it questions who we are. Questions who we are. Verse 3, during that time, the devil came and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, tell these stones to become loaves of bread." Now, Jesus is, in fact, the Son of God, and yet Satan tries to tempt him by first questioning who Jesus is, or maybe even what does that mean to be the Son of God. Okay? So not only who he is, but what does that mean to be the Son of God? All right? Are you really the Son of God? And of course, Satan knows full well that Jesus is who he is. He knows that full well. The demons always knew before human beings did. Jesus knows full well. What he's trying to do is to get Jesus the question, who he is and what does it mean to be the Son of God? I mean, after all, he says, born of a virgin, announced by the angels of God, are you really the Son of God? Or are these just stories that your mother told? Right. If you really are the Son of God, Jesus, how come you were not born into wealth? How come you weren't born into the household of kings? Why are you so hungry right now? I mean, 40 days without food. Surely, Jesus, if you are the Son of God, you have the right and the power to satisfy your own needs. So there it is. Take care of it. And in response, Jesus quotes Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy 8:3. He did it to teach you that people do not live by bread alone. Rather, we live by every word that comes from the mouth of the Lord. He quotes Deuteronomy, the teachings of Moses. Remember in the Garden of Eden, let's think about this for a minute, in the Garden of Eden, Satan tricked and tempted Eve and Adam, let's just be honest about it, with knowledge. That's what she tricked her with, knowledge, right? Did God really say, do not? Which gets Eve to thinking about who she is in the eyes of God. Why doesn't God want us to have this knowledge? Who are we that he is withholding this knowledge from us? Aren't Adam and I worthy of this knowledge? And the temptation suddenly becomes, don't we want to be like God and have this knowledge? It questions who we are. Adam and Eve are challenged not just by the good-looking fruit. Come on, friends. There's fruit all over the garden. Don't get lost in that. There's fruit everywhere. It's not what they're challenged by. They're challenged by the knowledge that can be obtained. So how does temptation question who we are? Well, how about those of us that are sitting around going, am I worthy of God's love? You know you are. But it challenges us. Why can't I have what I want in this life? Why do I have to be so poor? Am I really a Christian? Am I really a child of God? If I can't get the love I deserve from my marriage, well, then I'll just go get it from somewhere else. So you question who you are in your marriage. And the same thing happens with alcohol and with other temptations. dear friends. It questions who we are in Christ Jesus and within ourselves as well. So temptation gets us to question who we are, specifically in Christ Jesus, but elsewhere as well. And additionally, temptation, quite frankly, often sounds and looks really good. That's why it's temptation, right? Temptation looks and sounds good. Verse 6, and said, if you are the Son of God, now this is Satan talking again, if you are the Son of God, jump off, for the Scriptures say, he will order his angels to protect you, and they will hold you up with their hands so you won't even hurt your foot on a stone. Friends, Satan is a devious one for sure. Now he quotes Scripture to Jesus. Specifically, he quotes one of the greatest psalms of all time, Psalm 91, verses 11 and 12. A psalm of God's protection over his own. That's what that psalm is all about. It's a psalm of protection over his own. One of the commentaries I read said this, and I quote, Satan's deceit lay in misapplying his quotation into a temptation that easily traps the devout mind by apparently warranting what might otherwise be thought sinful. Jesus was not concerned over whether God would protect him, but rather over the fact that elsewhere in Scriptures forbid putting God to the test. So it is not the psalm itself that is in question, but instead its application that is devious. Think about it. It's Scripture, and he quotes it correctly. How can it be wrong? How can it be wrong, Jesus? I'm quoting your Scriptures. And it's not wrong, but the application by Satan is wrong. You want to learn more about that? Go look at Exodus 17, 2 through 7, or Numbers 20, 1 through 13. This is the event that Jesus will quote to him. At first blush, this looks very good because it is Scripture. And Satan doesn't misquote it. He quotes it correctly. He does leave off a little part at the end, but in general, he quotes it correctly. So it looks good to the devout, and yet it's misapplied. Again, Jesus responds to the quote with Deuteronomy, Deuteronomy 6:16. You must not test the Lord your God as you did when you complained at Massah. That's what he's talking about in those other two texts I just shared with you. For our heroine, Ariel, the shiny baubles and the lure of the surface world were beautiful to her. The prince was certainly a handsome man and to be desired. But she allowed those temptations to take her down a path that almost cost her everything. For me, those two young ladies were very pretty indeed. And again, it would have most likely cost me my marriage of 38 years and family and so on, had I given in. How did the song go several years ago? Some of you will remember this. Devil with the blue dress, blue dress, blue dress. Devil with the blue dress on. Right? Who was that? Who knows? Mitch Ryder. Yes. Mitch Ryder and the Detroit News was the name of the group. Devil with the blue dress on. Right? Yeah. It is a fact, beloved, that temptation looks good, sounds good, feels good. Otherwise, it wouldn't be temptation. Right? I mean, think about it. Temptation makes us question who we are, and it often looks really good. Finally, Temptation questions our loyalty. Verse 9, I will give it, again, Satan speaking here, I will give it all to you, he said, if you will kneel down and worship me. Satan took Jesus to a high peak in the wilderness to tempt him into breaking his loyalty to God. Again, here's the picture. I think I showed this to you a couple weeks ago. Here's a picture way up at the top of that peak there. About halfway down is a monastery that is dedicated to remembering the temptation. And most theologians believe, historians believe, that it was at the top of this peak that Jesus was taken to be tempted by Satan. And of course, none of that stuff that's down there now would have been there. Obviously, that would have all just been wilderness at that point. When Jesus was baptized, as he came up out of the water, the voice of God proclaimed this: "This is my dearly loved Son who brings me great joy." Remember, we talked about this with the baptism week a couple weeks ago. Matthew 3:17. Do you remember what I taught about why Jesus brought joy to the Father? Who remembers? Shout it out. Say it louder. I heard it. Thank you. Obedience. Yes. Obedience brought great joy to the Father. Right? And here's the key. Jesus would continue to be obedient going forward. And this is what Jesus was tempting him to not do in this temptation right here. You see, this event, this him coming up out of the water, God declaring he was the beloved Son, and that he was bringing great joy. What that did was it linked the Davidic Messiahship with the suffering servant of Isaiah. David coming in great power with the suffering servant of Isaiah. Many scholars believe that Satan was offering the Messiahship, that is, rule over everything on earth, without the suffering servant position. Jesus could achieve power while sidestepping the cross. That's what Satan was offering him. Don't worry about that cross, Jesus. You just sidestep that. We'll just give you everything. All you got to do is bend the knee to me. He could simply achieve power by worshiping God's rival instead. A shortcut, if you will. Just give up the Father's plan going forward. Little shortcut. Once again, Jesus quotes Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy 6:13 in this case. You must fear the Lord your God and serve him. When you take an oath, you must use only his name. Ariel is tempted to disobey her father, and she does so on more than one opportunity in the movie. Right? And she's tempted to take a shortcut to the love she desires in the prince. And I'm not saying that her love for the prince wasn't true. That's probably very true. The problem is she tried to use a shortcut to get there through Ursula the Sea Witch, who is evil personified in this movie. Okay? So many of the temptations of his life, this life, are subversive toward our loyalty to God and our faith walk. Think about it for a minute. Alcohol, pornography, materialism, sexual abuse, fame, fortune, etc. They all become our little g gods rather than the one true God. And our loyalty is tested. It's tempted. Often our temptations look for shortcuts to get what we want, but do not have to pay the price of patience or steadfastness or endurance in getting there. If I could just take this little shortcut, you know, what's it going to cost me? Who cares? I want it, and I want it now. Temptation lurks everywhere and in every form, dear friends. So what can we do to assuage the temptations that haunt us? That's a good question we ought to ask ourselves. Well, what did Jesus do? He sought solace and strength in the Scriptures and in his relationship with God, with the Father. That's the primary place he went, the Scriptures. Right? So here's the first thing I'd say. Find solace and strength in the Scriptures. Satan is the father of all lies. He will even use Scripture against itself if you're not careful. He tried to with Jesus. Which, of course, then means that we must know the Scriptures in order for us to call upon them in times of temptation. Dear friends, the Scriptures are being abused and misused in our modern world today. It's happening all the time. And it's happening in churches. So the first thing is find solace and strength in the Scriptures. You got to know them in order to find solace in them, in order to call them to memory in times of temptation. Okay? How do you get to know them? You know the answer to that. Be wary of shortcuts that seem too good to be true. Because they are too good to be true, usually at least, right? Scriptures over and over again tell us to be patient, be long-suffering, endure, stay the course, and so on. I just looked up the word patient, be patient, be patience, and there are 50 times where that word is used, and there are 250-plus times where endurance, patience, long-suffering are used all combined together, okay? One of the most quoted one is Romans 12:12. Rejoice in our confident hope. Be patient in trouble and keep on praying. Patience. Don't try and circumnavigate because you usually get in trouble when you do. Got Ariel in a lot of trouble. Right? Listen to the still small voice in your head and your heart. This is most likely the Holy Spirit trying to steer you away from temptation that will harm you. We didn't see it in the clip, but there's a spot in the video there. Actually, they kind of jumped right over it, where Ariel is tempted by the two eels, right? And then she says, no, Ursula the witch, no, I can't do that. She knows in her heart. She knows, it's that still small voice. She knows that she can't go to the Ursula the Sea Witch, and she tells them to go away, so they start swimming away. And then she calls them back. Wait, she says. If she'd have just listened to the still small voice in her own heart, in her own mind, she would have known. She did know, but she caved into the temptation, and she went swimming off with the eels to Ursula. So listen to that still small voice. We have all had that sense, every single one of us, I'm sure, at one time. That feeling, if you will, of we call them spider tingles. Our spider tingles, right? They start going off. That's the Holy Spirit telling us, run away. Stay strong in the Lord Jesus. If Ariel had done that, she would have never run into that whole issue with the sea witch. And again, one last call for this. Please, please, please seek professional help if necessary. If your struggle is with addictions of drugs or alcohol or pornography, any of those things, please seek professional Christian counseling. If you don't know a good one, I can give you some names of some really good Christian counselors right here in the area. So if that's you, I'll keep it private, I promise. But come tell me, and we'll get you the help you need. Okay? I promise you. I'll leave a final word from our founder, John Wesley. John Wesley wrote a sermon entitled, Of Temptation, the nature and power of it. That's the way he wrote it. By the way, the sermon is 6 chapters long. Not 6 paragraphs, not 6 pages, 6 chapters long. One sermon on temptation. I'm going to quote him here. It's King's English, so bear with me. It is impossible that we should be so freed as not to be at all tempted. Whilst Satan continues in his power and malice, whilst the world and lusts are in being, we shall be tempted. Christ, says one, was made like unto us that he might be tempted. And we are tempted that we may be made like unto Christ. Temptation in general is comprehensive of our whole warfare. We have no promise that we shall not be tempted at all, nor are to pray for an absolute freedom from temptations, because we have no promise of being heard therein. The direction we have for our prayers is, lead us not into temptation, Matthew 6:9, Jesus' words himself as he taught the Lord's Prayer. Lead us not into temptation. Therefore, it is entering into temptation that we are to pray against. We may be tempted, yet not enter into temptation. You understand the difference? This life is filled with temptations. They're everywhere. What we pray in the Lord's Prayer is, lead us not into the temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. Okay? Therein is the difference. So, dear friends, if any of this is you, seek solace in God's Word. Get the help you need if that's necessary. I'm here to help. Jesus can relate to temptation. Amen? And amen. I am very pleased to invite the Reverend Judy DeBries up here to come share with us our prayer concerns for this morning. As you may or may not know, some of you might know, some of you might not, Judy is a chaplain at Bronson Methodist, Cancer Center, that's what I was trying to say, the Cancer Center. And we were her sponsors at the annual conference to allow her to get ordained into the chaplaincy in our denomination. And so we had the blessing and honor of laying hands on her as she was being ordained an elder in the Global Methodist Church. And she is now attending our church and has become a member and is now willing to assist and help. So she's going to have our prayer time.
Good morning. We've already said that a couple times, but here I am to say good morning to you. Right here? Okay. All right. We have lots of prayer requests this morning. We're thankful for the prayers and support for God's Special Needs, Special People's Camp. They had a great week. Thank you for all the people that came to donate blood on Friday. 24 years ago today, we prayed for a NICU baby girl, and today we praise God for her 24 years with us. Happy birthday, Sierra. This is a long one. Of course, it came from Christina, huh? I guess. She wants us to pray for all the college students heading back to school this week, and including her, Logan. Prayers for the younger school-age kids as they're preparing to go back to school. Prayers for the teachers, for all that goes into starting that fall time again. Thank you This is from Ashley. Thank you to all the Pathfinder women for showing up, huh? You like that they showed up for you, for your bridal shower. The love and support of the church is amazing and is truly a blessing. And a praise to go along with that is that Jan was there. Absolutely, Jan was there. And she attended the shower and she looked great. She also has been able to attend her small group. She is our walking miracle. We pray for peace all over this world. We pray for our friend, Nikki Radke, I think I said that right, who is just diagnosed with ovarian and liver cancer. Prayers for our friend, Cindy, who is having complications from total knee surgery. John Chapman passed away peacefully at home on Thursday following a long battle with cancer. Prayers for wife Peggy and the children. And there's an address on here that you can probably get from the office later to send condolences and cards to bless them during this time. I'm also going to read to you this morning the 40 days of prayer before a convening conference. With God, all things are possible, even conveying general conference. We pray that our volunteers won't feel like they are trying to do the impossible. Give them your peace as they work on their schedules, agendas, and calendars. May they find joy in doing so, knowing that you are beside them in every move. May it all work together for good and bless with your favor the members of the committee of calendar and agenda. Please pray with me now. Dear Lord, we are just grateful to be in this house today to worship you, to remember to turn our eyes upon you. We lift all these requests up to you as we walk through a world that offers us all kinds of sparkling little distractions that may turn into big distractions. Our world sometimes feels as though it's upside down, and it's hard sometimes to continue to seek you, to seek your solace in Scripture. But Lord, we know that you've got this, that you're in charge, and that all these things will come to fruition in their own time. Be with us now as we pray the prayer that you taught us to pray. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Let's all stand up and worship the Lord together.
My name was lost till your love reached down. You rescued me, now my name is found. I was a slave to my sin and shame, but those chains fell off when you changed my name. You changed my name, you changed my name, from too far gone to stay by grace, and now I am.
The old is gone.
call me. I don't have to answer to any name but chosen child of God. I don't have to answer to any name that the enemy tries to call me. I don't have to answer to any name but chosen child of God.
Thanks for being here today in worship with us. Receive this blessing. Just as God's word was sent into the world to heal and redeem, so God sends you into the world this day to be light and love, to be healing and hope. So go now to be light for the world, and may the grace and peace of God the Creator, God the Redeemer, God the Sustainer come upon you this day and remain with you always. And all God's people said,
Amen.
Amen. Have a great day.
Three.